Leute, willkommen zu 1.4.9.22.1.7.134, dem Anarchie Vanilla Minecraft Server. Und wir schauen heute einen Talk von dem Linux Conf AO 2017 Hubert Australia Channel. Ein Kanal mit 3600 Abonnenten. Und da schauen wir ein Video von 2017 mit dem Titel, oh, was ist meine Steinkiste hier? Ja, hätten wir auch da vorne reinbauen können, ne, egal. Mit dem Titel A Guide to Selecting FOSS Licenses for Programmers and Open Culture Enthusiasts. Oh mein Gott, also ich struggle ein bisschen mit, allein weil der Kanalname 1000 Zeichen lang ist. Link zum Video ist wie immer in der Beschreibung, sowie die IP-Adresse zu diesem Server. Falls sich die Adresse des Servers ändert, könnt ihr natürlich immer auch in die mal auf dem Kanal suchen, ob es neuere Videos gibt zu Updates zu diesem Server, weil dieser Server auch in den nächsten Jahren noch online sein wird und wer weiß, was sich in den nächsten Jahren so ändert. Aber diese Map hier soll eigentlich nicht verloren gehen und zur Not werde ich auch, wenn ich es nicht mehr schaffe, für den Server zu zahlen, diese Map veröffentlichen und vielleicht wird dann jemand anderes diesen Server weiter betreiben. Deswegen, genau, wenn ihr fern aus der Zukunft kommt, schaut einfach mal auf dem Kanal nach einem Update-Video. Alles klar. Und sonst würde ich sagen, starten wir jetzt den Talk. Und let's go.
Looking at free and open source licenses and context of existing copyright regimes. Please give them a warm welcome.
Ich hoffe, das ist laut genug für euch.
Well, thank you very much for everyone for coming along. Hopefully this talk will be informative and useful, and you'll get something out of it. It's in the broader context of my research into basically
Jesus.
user-generated versus
Chill, man.
vehicles.
Was ist hier los?
First, I thought I might start with a disclaimer, which is I am technically a lawyer, but not a practicing lawyer. I'm also not your lawyer. Nothing I'm saying today should be construed as legal advice or
Ich bin mal gespannt, ob es ein Video
anything
gibt,
of
das nicht so
legal
anfängt.
import. So, basically, if you need legal advice on something, it's really important that you should speak to a real lawyer if there's something that you desperately need legal advice. But hopefully the point of this talk is to act as a primer on legal issues for open source licensing, and this is something that where people can actually, and developers can actually use this information to work out how to license their own projects without the need for a lawyer, except in absolute necessity. Something that I went to Bradley Cun's talk yesterday about GPL license enforcement, and he mentioned that often licensing choice is a choice for the user. So in particular, with respect to copyleft licensing, there's an argument that because it excludes proprietary software, that it's a choice for the user to choose how to license their work. I guess what this talk is about is the matters to consider when licensing your own project. So at the very start of the licensing process, how do you make sure that
Wow, irgendwie
you've
der
chosen the
Ton
right
tut weh.
license for
Oh,
what you intend
Jungs,
to
was ist denn da schon wieder mit der Audioqualität los?
And the essence of this talk is designed to cut through some of the confusion which is
Well, I pressed the
around
button.
open source licensing. Obviously, this is a topic which is of great importance to many programmers and free culture enthusiasts, but there still seems to be a fair bit of confusion about actually how open source licenses operate and how, in particular, how they relate to the public domain, how they relate to copyright. So, because this is a legal talk on open source licensing, I think it's appropriate to include the obligatory lesson quote. Lawyers give and take work, they would contribute their ideas they found in the space. So the idea is that in fields such as open source licensing, user-generated law, where developers and users are actually driving the formation of new legal rules, lawyers would hopefully take a secondary role in that process, and ultimately developers should drive the process of how open source licenses are used. So essentially this talk is just to give some background about what you want to do with the open source license. So the next slide, why license? Recently, there's been a report by the Productivity Commission of, in Australia into our intellectual property arrangements. That report was broadly supportive of the idea of open source development and the contributions that it brings to the Australian economy in terms of promoting free software development and providing a base of tools that can be used for further innovation. That was also talked about in relation to existing intellectual property laws, including copyright law and patent law. Now, something that is somewhat troubling about the report is that it seems to equate open source development with some form of public domain development. And from a legal perspective, these two concepts are quite different. For those of you who attended Richard's talk on Wednesday, I apologise for the repetition, but copyright is a right that's given rise to by the Berne Convention, which requires that member states implement copyright laws. Now, that convention also states that copyright arises without registration. So any time you're sitting around, you're developing software, and then you publish it, there's a copyright which automatically arises and attaches to the software that you developed. Now, if you release software without a license, that's great if you want that software to be as widely used as possible. There's examples, CERN, the HTTP daemon, BLAST, which is a pattern matching algorithm in genomic daemons. There's a copyright which automatically arises and attaches to the software that you developed. Now, if you release software without a license, that's great if you want that software to be as widely used as possible.
Ohne Lizenz ist es widely used.
HTTP daemon, BLAST, which was developed, which is a pattern matching algorithm in genomic analysis, are both examples of public domain works which have been licensed very broadly. However, there is an issue insofar that when you do release a work without a license, there is copyright that attaches to it, but it's a bare license. And what a bare license allows you to do is basically say, well, you can revoke the license, but that's about it. You have no further control over how the software is used. And that can be problematic from the perspective of other developers, because it may discourage people from using your code. At the turn of the century and throughout, at the turn of the millennium, there was a lot of discussion about fear, uncertainty, and doubt about open source licensing. There were many complaints that using open source would make it impossible to rely on proprietary software. But equally, without a license, it is possible that that may make it difficult for other developers to work out how to use your software. So, why should you license your code? You should license your code if you want to control who uses it. You want to control how they use it, and you want to control what software they use it with. So that, in essence, is the purpose of open source licensing from a, I guess, a contractual legal perspective, to define some contours on copyright, which can be used on the copyright license, which is attached to the work, to ensure that it can be used in a particular fashion. So in the next slide, I'm going to talk about how open source licenses work at law. So, start with, it's a combination of contract and copyright law. Now, one of the early concerns about open source licensing, looking back at literature, was, well, how can you have a contract when there's no money changing hands? How can you have a contract when software is being delivered for free? Strictly speaking, contracts usually involve some form of monetary payment in exchange for goods, but that doesn't necessarily involve some form of consideration, but that doesn't necessarily need to be a monetary payment. So when you do release open source software and someone downloads it, it could be argued that by downloading your software, they receive a number of benefits, including the right, you receive a number of benefits from them downloading your software, including the fact that they're using your work, recognition rights, and also the right to continue to develop your work. So there are a number of intangible benefits which attach to the downloading of that software, or the use of your software. So accordingly, there is some form of contractual relationship which
ich normalerweise nur License ohne TXT.
Upstream and downstream compatibility, which is something that you need to consider. consider when you are licensing your project. I believe Bradley is the expert on GPL enforcement, so I'll defer to his judgment, but I believe in situations where you have licensed your work under the GPL, you need to basically keep on licensing that work under the same license or any derivatives thereof. So once you've made that choice, it's important that you are certain that you want to make that decision. Something that I will address later is, and you should note, is that copyleft licensing does not necessarily mean that the software can be monetized. It simply means that no reach-through licensing fees can be charged. So, the next stage of this talk is to address when is an open source license breach? What are the contours of the open source of particular open source licenses? So, starting with permissive licenses, they can be breached when there's no attribution. So, if you include openly licensed code without reference to, if you include openly licensed code, for instance, in a proprietary work, without reference to the original developer, then that can lead to a breach of the license. And there has actually been litigation in this regard, perhaps one of the most famous open source cases, Jacobson Katzer, which concerned openly licensed modern railway software. So the question was, so the defendant in this case basically took some of the plaintiff's openly licensed code under the artistic license, put it in a proprietary package, removed all the attribution notices, and kept on selling it as his own work. So that raised the question, was there actually breach? And that raised a further question, could the plaintiff seek remedies under contract and copyright law? Now, this is something important that to bear in mind, which is what remedies can be actually sought. So if an open source license is just construed as a contractual license between two parties, in the United States, you can only seek damages for the use of that software. Now, for many open source developers, I imagine this is probably an unsatisfactory state of affairs. If you have taken the trouble to openly license your code, you would want to make sure that it is continually licensed, which raises the question of copyright remedies. So if it's a copyright, if those are copyright conditions, they are conditions on use, then they would allow you to seek other remedies such as an injunction. An injunction is effectively a court order which allows you to stop doing something. So which allows you to force someone else to stop doing something or to comply with something. So in the context of Jacobson and Katzer, Jacobson was seeking an injunction to force the defendant in this case to re-license the code or release the code under an open license. And looking at the terms of the open license in that question, the United States Court of Appeals said, yes, these terms can be construed as conditions. They amounted to conditions, as you found use, rather than just covenants, which, if breached, would only give right to damages. So, that's a permissive work. So permissive work, basically, the most likely case where someone may breach your license is if they include your code without attribution. What about restrictive licenses? Well, we know that there are remedies for lack of attribution, but there are also remedies for failure to re-license the derivative work, failure to comply with the copyleft clauses. So that raises the question, what is a derivative work and how far do these remedies extend? Now, there is a recent case in this regard in the United States District Court of California, Drugless and Cap and Map Group, and I've included the image along with appropriate copyright notice, appropriate attribution for the plaintiff in this regard. So this was licensed under a Creative Commons CC BY-SA license. So the question here was, this particular work was included in a map compilation and without the attribution notice. So Drugless went to court and asked the court to not only license and not only include the attribution, but also require the map producers to re-license the whole thing under a Creative Commons work. Now, with respect to whether he was successful in that regard, the court said no. That was was not a derivative work. So the breach of the and court confirmed that the breach of the share alike copyleft terms depended on there being a derivative work. So the photograph was only part of a broader compilation. It did not represent the map. The map itself, the maps, and the map book did not represent a relicensing of the broader compilation, or it did not represent a transformation of that. So therefore, it couldn't be considered a derivative work, and therefore the copyleft requirements didn't apply. All that the map producers had to do in this case was include the appropriate CC BY-SA attribution and the attribution for the author. So that clearly shows you that courts are setting the boundaries for the how far open source licenses can be enforced, which is a double-edged sword because on one hand, I'm sure no one here likes litigation. It's a costly process. I'm sure everyone feels that the only people who win out of litigation are lawyers. But on the flip side, license enforcement does define the boundaries of an open source license. So when that happens, that reduces a little, that creates a little less uncertainty as to the extent of the open source license. And as I'm sure many of you are aware, that uncertainty is still present, for example, in with respect to derivative software. In particular, the recent decision with Google and Oracle has thrown a significant amount of uncertainty with respect to APIs. For those of you who are not familiar with the case, that concerned Google's re-implementation of Oracle's Java APIs for Android. And the question before the United States Court of Appeals was did that amount to a breach of copyright? Was there copyright attached to the APIs? And if so, was Google's use of that covered by fair use? Now, this decision has positive aspects and negative aspects. The good news is that, I guess from the perspective of free and open source software developers, was that eventually one of the lower courts, the Court of Appeals, sent that back and said, and the jury concluded, yes, this was fair use, which is positive in the sense that it does place some limitations on how the holders of proprietary licenses can enforce their rights against open source developers. The flip side was, though, that in this case, the United States Court of Appeals concluded that there was copyright attached to the APIs. Now, that's problematic because, as we discussed earlier, copyright is something that attaches to literary works. It doesn't necessarily have a functional aspect, and this is the functional expressive divide within copyright law and patent law. Patent law is designed to protect functional works. Copyright law is designed to protect primarily literary works. Now, in this case, the APIs were, it was just a re-implementation of Java's library. I believe Bradley has written a blog post, and I'm sure Aaron has written many works as well, to point out that basically this was a re-implementation of a number of different APIs which were floating around, and it was necessary for Google in order to do this, in order to have Android work. So then that becomes a question: should copyright attach to something which is purely functional, which is commonly used, or where there are already many examples of that floating around and, you know, that are available online, and occurred accordingly, where it's purely functional. There's no originality necessarily attached to the API. So what does that mean for derivative software in the context of software works? Ultimately, it depends on a case-by-case basis, which I'm sure is a frustrating answer. But so basically, what you need to do is you need to look at whether it's a commonly used method, or it's a re-implementation of an API, or it's a complicated implementation, or a unique functionality in a library. So that may depend on searching for other libraries which exist, and also the degree of functionality which is present in the work. So I'll now turn to address open licensing outside the United States, and many of the existing open source licenses have been designed to operate within the boundaries of the US Copyright Act, which defines derivative works. Now, Australian and US copyright law, there's no definition of derivative work. Instead, we rely on adaptation. So the question now is this a suitable substitute for derivative work? Do these things mean the same thing? So an adaptation is a transformation of a work into a new form of work. So the classic example is a screenplay based off a novel. There has been some case law in Australia which says a computer program which defines a particular pattern, when that is translated into a physical pattern, that is an adaptation of that work. So it's not strictly analogous to derivative works, but on the flip side, the Berne Convention does provide scope for copyright holders to have rights within adaptations, so it is possible that they are analogous. In addition, Australia has a number of exceptions to copyright infringement, including creating interoperable programs and for creating software for using software in the normal use of software. Now, whether that actually extends to open source licensing is another matter. Unfortunately, these provisions were drafted at the time when proprietary software development in mind. Obviously, there was still open source development occurring, but the actual drafters of this legislation weren't necessarily considering the iterative style of development within open source. So whether those exceptions necessarily cover open source development is another matter. Finally, I thought I might like to turn to questions of open data licensing. So copyright vests when there's originality in a particular work. So recent case law in Australia and fairly old case law in the United States, Vice Telecommunications confirms that mere compilations of data lack originality for copyright to vest. So, but in that regard, it's necessary to distinguish between the contents and the actual compilation of data. The contents itself may be protected by copyright. The compilation itself lacks probably by itself sufficient originality for data to vest. For Europeans, for people working in the European Union, it's important also to remember the sui generis database rights and the database directive, which is provided for by various acts, which provides an additional right associated with database rights, and that creates further complications for open source licensing. So there are, obviously, one option is to use public domain licensing to release some of the data to the public domain. Creative Commons, I believe, have been driving a project in order to create open database licensing. Another option is potentially dual licensing. So you may choose to release the software under an open license, but at the same time, the data, you may either wish to keep that a secret or use a bespoke license. So that may be important in the context of scientific research, where, for instance, you have patient data. You may not wish to release the patient data under an open source license. You may wish to keep that confidential because of the privacy concerns associated with it. Or alternatively, you may have your own license coupled with the data. It's important to remember that there are different rights associated with the software and the data, despite the close linkage between the two. So coming to the final slides in this work, so basically, if you want to spread your source code as widely as possible and you don't care about how people use it and you're happy for it to be included potentially in other open source works, potentially in proprietary works, public domain licensing is probably your best option. If you do want attribution, so in an academic context, or you may wish to include your source code or let someone include it in a proprietary package, permissive licensing may be the best if you can care about controlling use and attribution.
Aber public license erlaubt den Leuten nicht,
but if you
für
want greater control over derivative control included in a proprietary package.
Das ist, do you want to include your source code in a proprietary? Hä, aber wenn ich was Public Domain mache, kann ich es doch auch Proprietary machen, nicht? Wieso nicht?
Permissive licensing may be the best if you can care about controlling use and attribution. But if you want greater control over derivative works and you prefer it if your software remains openly available, then it would be probably best to rely on restrictive licensing. It's important to note in this context that the GPL is not necessarily a non-commercial license. software. It's just that you can't rely on that you can't necessarily charge read-through licensing fees. Finally, if you have, you may wish to consider separate licenses for data and software, including maybe a dual proprietary permissive license or open source software licensing and proprietary data. And that's the end of my talk. Any questions?
Associated with. So I'm very uneasy about the lack of a link between the body of the code and a separate file called license.txt, which they all call license.txt. What's the link?
Okay, so there's, again, the idea behind these, I guess, using that phrase, unfortunate phrase, click wrap or shrink wrap style licensing, is that it's present when you start to use the software. So before the user can actually use the software, it's presented to them. And that's something that you would need to consider when actually developing your software. As I mentioned earlier, as Bradley and Karen talked about yesterday, there was some discussion about corporate counsel actually suggesting that you bury the license deep within the source code. That means that it's unlikely to be seen by anyone who's using the software. The best bet is to, or the perhaps the best way of bringing it to the attention of potential users is to have it attached to the downloads. So if you host your own website, you may include this software is licensed under a appropriate license to let users know this is what the license is actually attached to. Perhaps as part of a compile script, have this software is licensed under this work. If you have a graphical installer, perhaps a window to demonstrate that. So basically, you need to show that you've taken steps to bring it to the attention of the attention of potential users to show that they are bound. Does that answer your question?
Nicht wirklich, oder? Also ja, schon ein bisschen, aber ja. Ich bin noch ein bisschen confused.
Oh yes, if I release something under GPL, then people are subsequently not allowed to re-release it under MIT. But if I release it under GPL, can I then do a subsequent version, perhaps with very few changes, under the MIT license? Or am I bound by my own GPL code?
Gute Frage.
Yes, you do have control over how you license the work. It's just a matter of subsequent users and developers who are bound by your exclusive rights. So when you are the original developer of the work, your exclusive rights as a copyright holder still do vest with you. So yes.
Yes, you can, oder?
Implemented their Copyright Act, their current iteration of their Copyright Act after the Berne Convention, and that hasn't been tested within Australia. So it's possible that adaptation and derivative work may not necessarily have the same meaning. For what it's worth, I am writing a submission to the Productivity Commission, and along with a number of other people at the University of Tasmania, which will include a statement to the effect of derivative, that difference between derivative works and adaptation should be cleared up. Does that answer your question?
Question over here.
Okay.
So I was particularly interested in your comments about contractual and copyright license obligations and how they interact. You're probably aware that there was a historical view in free software licensing theory communities, and I admit to have previously been a proponent of this idea that it should never be interpreted as a contract. I've slowly softened that view, partly because of Jacobson and other reasons as well, that I think it's probably safe for us to allow the free software licenses to operate both as copyright licenses and contracts. I'm curious if in your research you found anything that indicates one way or another. Is there any danger in what you found letting them operate as both at once, and are there advantages?
In my own research, no, I haven't found anything that would suggest that it's dangerous. My main research seems to conclude around and seems to concern how licenses are actually drafted to, so whether the terms of the license are drafted as conditions or use, or whether they're defined more loosely. So I believe there are problems with the JSON license, as an example, where it basically creates all of these very sort of vague terms. So the artistic license, although there's been a lot of academic criticism, as I'm sure you're aware, of the artistic license in the sense that it's very vague. The Free Software Foundation has issued a statement saying we don't know if this is copyleft or not, which is pretty problematic. The court said, well, these are still defined as conditions, so I can't see that being the problem. My understanding of the research is that the main problem is the vagueness of the rights associated with the license.
So you were saying the simplest license, if you just want to say have identity as public domain, and I've been told that in the US actually it doesn't give you any rights because it doesn't actually spell them out, and that they're supposed to be spelled out like they are at MIT or BSD. So the recommendation I've always been given and been told to give is if you want the freest license, pick MIT, BSD, but public domain doesn't give you those rights because it doesn't spell them out.
Yeah, so that was the point that I made on my final slide. So if you want, like, basically,
the slide was kind of contradicting the previous one, so I was kind of wondering what is your take on this, since you were saying both things.
Well, my take would be if you want the minimal rights possible, then you should probably, if you want minimal rights possible, you should probably license under a permissive license. Public domain should be one of those things where you're absolutely sure you want to have no control over the work. Like, are you sure about this? Otherwise, you should probably default to a permissive license. That's my answer.
Let's finish that up separately.
Oh my
okay,
God.
So we are out of time. Thank you all for attending, and let's give James a round of applause.
Ja Leute, das war's dann auch wieder mit dieser Folge hier auf Laserguckenland mit dem Video A Guide to Selecting FOSS Licenses for Programmers and Open Culture Enthusiast. Von wem war das? Ich weiß es nicht, von wem es war. Egal, Link ist auf jeden Fall in der Beschreibung und wir sehen uns dann in der nächsten Folge dieser Dauerwerbesendung wieder. Die IP des Servers ist 1.4.9.202.1.27.1.3.4 momentan, aber falls sich das updatet, schaut am besten mal in die Beschreibung oder auf dem Kanal in eines der neueren Videos. Nämlich sagen, sehen wir uns in der nächsten Folge wieder.